Greetings to all my dear students. So in our second session, in continuation of the first session, we are going to discuss something about principles of pharmacology. Okay, let us see what it is all about. So principles of pharmacology. I'm going to cover the nature of drugs, sources of drugs, and sources of drug information in this topic. So first, the nature of drugs. So we're going to cover the nature of drugs and physical nature of drugs, drug size, shape, reactivity and receptor bonds, chirality, and rational drug design and receptor nomenclature in this session. So nature of drugs. A drug may be defined as any substance that brings about a change in biological function through its chemical actions by interacting with the molecule receptors. The drug molecule interacts as an agonist or activator or antagonist or inhibitor with a specific target molecule that plays a regulatory role, that is the receptor, in the biological system. So this target molecule is called as a receptor. So example here, we will take beta agonist and antagonist. So when it combines, a particular drug molecule combines with the receptor which produces agonistic or activating the receptor mediation is known as the agonist. Whereas the beta blockers, which when we use these drugs, when combined with particular receptors, they inhibit the activity of the agonist. So they are called as antagonists. Then drugs known as chemical antagonists may interact directly with other drugs, that is like chelating agents, like antidotes when we give, they combine with the lead molecule, for example, and then nullify the toxic effects that the particular compound produces. That is like a chemical antagonist, antagonistic action when it is combined with a chemical molecule, okay? Then a few drugs like osmotic agents interact almost exclusively with water molecule. That is, example is mannitol. Through the process of osmosis, it exhibits its pharmacodynamic actions. Then Paracelsus famously stated that the dose makes the poison. Any substance can be harmful if taken in the wrong dosage. That means like excessive doses, specifically to say. And toxins are usually defined as poisons of biologic origin synthesized by either plants or animals. And even inorganic poisons like lead and arsenic also have the toxic manifestations. Then drugs are generally perceived to be chemical substances foreign to the body. That is like xenobiotics. When we administer the drugs into the body externally, that is called as xenobiotics. But endogenous chemicals like hormones, corticoids, metabolites, and nutrients are also used as drugs. Modification or modulation of the endogenous chemicals. Then chemical congeners of these metabolites or signal molecules are an important class of drugs, which act by modifying the synthesis, storage, degradation, or action of these metabolites or signaling molecules. Then physical nature of drugs. All drugs are chemical entities with simple or complex molecules. So in this category, we have organic compounds as well as inorganic compounds. Organic compounds, this is the majority of the drug molecules come under the category organic compounds, and they can be categorized in a different way. That is like number one, weakly acidic, where we can see, for example, aspirin and penicillin, and weakly basic molecules like morphine and chloroquine, and non-electrolytes like alcohol. Whereas inorganic compounds, the most common examples are ferrous sulfate and magnesium hydroxide. Then useful or dangerous drugs which come under the category of inorganic compounds are lithium, iron salts, and heavy metals. Then other classes of organic compounds like carbohydrates, proteins, lipids, and smaller molecules are also there. And apart from that, we do have oligonucleotides in the form of small segments of RNA that have entered into the zone of clinical trials and pharmacotherapeutics. Then drugs can also be classified by their nature, that is like solids, liquids, and gaseous drugs. Solids examples are paracetamol, ampicillin, aspirin, atropine tablets, and liquids, ethanol, which also can act as a medicine, and then nicotine and castor oil. These are all in liquid form. And then gaseous form, that is the common example is nitrous oxide. So the solid or liquid or gaseous form, this nature of a particular drug determines the best route of administration. So which route we need to administer. Then comes drug size. The molecular weight of majority of drugs falls in the range of 100 to 1000 daltons. The lower limit of this narrow range is probably set by the requirements for specificity of action. That means minimum 100 daltons molecular weight has to be there for getting a proper specific action of a particular drug. Then molecules smaller than 100 daltons, they do not have no specific size, shape, configuration, chirality, distribution of charges, etc. to selectively bind to only one or few closely related target biomolecules. So what happens when we take the molecules less than 100, very small molecules, then they will not have any specific size or shape, all these characteristic features, including the chirality and distribution charges. So they cannot combine selectively to a target molecule or a receptor. That is the disadvantage. And then if we go beyond 1000 daltons, larger molecules, then what happens? They cannot readily pass through membranes or barriers in the body to reach the target sites in various tissues or cells. Suppose we will be giving the drug through oral administration. It has to reach the liver or kidney. So if you give very large molecules, they cannot readily pass through the membrane barriers to reach the target site of action. That is the other advantage. So that is the reason why majority of the drugs lie in the range between 100 to 1000 daltons, not less than that, not more than that. Then very small drug molecules, example is molecular weight 7 daltons, lithium ion. Big drug molecules like very large molecules, that is molecular weight like 59,000 alteplase, a protein, and heparin has 10 to 20,000 daltons, gonadotropins more than 30,000 daltons, and enzymes, proteins, and antibodies have more than 50,000 daltons, very much bigger molecules. So bulky drug molecules have to be administered parently. That means directly at the site of action we need to administer, because they cannot cross the biological membranes. Then comes the drug size. To have a good fit to only one type of particular receptor, a drug molecule must be sufficiently unique in shape, charge, and other properties to prevent its binding to other receptors. So that is what is known as selective binding. So binding to only particular receptor which we want it to happen. So to achieve such selective binding, it appears that a molecule should in most cases be at least 100 molecular weight units in size, not less than that and not more than 1000, okay? So drugs much larger than molecular weights 1000 do not diffuse readily between compartments. So we have seen that one. So from the site of administration, they cannot reach the target site of action. And very large drugs, like usually proteins, must often be administered directly into the compartment where they have their effect. Like, for example, alteplase, a clot dissolving enzyme, is administered directly either into the vascular compartment, either by intravenous or intra-arterial infusion. Then comes drug shape. The shape of a drug molecule must be such as to permit binding to its receptor site via the bonds just described. Okay. The drug shape is complementary to that of the receptor site in the same way that a key is complementary to a lock. So, like for example, a lock is there and a key is there. So the key is made depending on the structure of the hole of that particular lock. So similarly, receptor and that the drug molecule, they should be like complementary, like that of the key to a lock. Then only the drug fits in the binding site of the receptor. Then to interact chemically with its receptor, a drug molecule must have appropriate size, shape, electrical charge, and atomic composition. A drug is often administered at a location distant from its intended site of action. Like for example, a pill is given orally to relieve headache. So it is a distant site of action. So a lot of the thing that it has to traverse pharmacokinetics, then to produce the pharmacodynamic action, relieving of the headache. Therefore, a useful drug must have the necessary properties to be transported from its site of administration to its site of action. Finally, a practical drug should be inactivated or excreted from the body at a reasonable rate so that its actions will be of appropriate duration. So the drug should not continuously giving pharmacodynamic action but presenting in the body for a long period of time. That also is detrimental to the patient. So the actions has to be terminated. For that, a drug has to be inactivated and to be get excreted out of the body. Then drug reactivity and drug receptor bonds. Drugs interact with receptors by means of three types of chemical forces of bonds, which is covalent, electrostatic, and hydrophobic bonds. Let us see what is this. You must be aware of this, just a recap of that thing. Covalent bonds, very strong and are irreversible under biological conditions. So we'll take one example to understand the covalent bonds with the drug molecules. Covalent bond formed between the acetyl group of acetyl salicylic acid, which is otherwise known as aspirin, and cyclooxygenase enzyme, which is present in the target cells, that is the platelets. So aspirin molecule is given. So which is the chemical name of the aspirin molecule is acetyl salicylic acid based on its chemical structure. So acetyl salicylic acid, it has to act upon the cyclooxygenase enzyme which is present in the platelets. So what happens? Acetyl molecule of the aspirin combines with the cyclooxygenase enzyme of the platelets to produce its pharmacodynamic action. So the combination attachment is through covalent bonds, which is a very strong bond and is irreversible under biological conditions. So it will not be broken down. It is very strong. So the platelet aggregation blocking effect of aspirin, that is the target effect that we are expecting. So it lasts long. Why? Because it is irreversible. It is not going to become normal or reversible under any circumstances. So it can be reversed only by the fresh synthesis of new enzyme, new platelet cyclooxygenase enzyme. In new platelets, a process that takes several days. So because it is irreversible phenomenon. Then electrostatic bonds, which are more common than covalent bonding in drug receptor interactions. So they are weaker than covalent bonds. They vary from relatively strong linkages between permanently charged ionic molecules to weaker hydrogen bonds and very weak induced dipole interactions such as van der Waals forces and similar phenomena. So it lies between very strong and very weak. That is electrostatic bonds. Then hydrophobic bonds. Weak and important in the interactions of highly lipid-soluble drugs with the lipids of cell membranes and perhaps in the interaction of drugs with the internal walls of receptor pockets. So mostly highly lipid-soluble drugs go ahead with the hydrophobic bonds. They are very weak in nature, and drugs that bind through weak bonds to their receptors are generally more selective than drugs that bind by many means of very strong bonds. What is the reason for it? Because weak bonds require a very precise fit of the drug to a receptor molecule if an interaction is to occur. So weak bonds are more selective, and for a proper selectivity, minimum molecular weight has to be 100 daltons. These two points that we have studied till now. A few substances that are completely inert in the chemical sense have also significant pharmacological effects. Example, xenon, an inert gas, has anesthetic effects at elevated pressures only. That is a specific effect. Then chirality or stereoisomerism. Let us see. More than half of all useful drugs are chiral molecules. That is, they can exist as enantiomeric pairs. Drugs with two asymmetric centers have four diastereoisomers. Example, ephedrine, esympathem, emetic trip. So I'll tell you in the, what is this chirality and what is this enantiomeric phase. Enantiomers means mirror images. So this is a drug molecule, enantiomer. And the pair of that particular enantiomer molecule is like mirror image to this one. And they are called as chiral molecules when they cannot be overlapped exactly on the other enantiomers. Where two enantiomers cannot be overlapped because they are mirror images, they cannot be overlapped. So they are referred to as chiral molecules. In most cases, one of these enantiomers is much more potent than its mirror image enantiomer, reflecting a better fit to the receptor molecule. So two enantiomers will be there, which are mirror images. So one will be more potent than the other one. If one imagines the receptor site to be like a globe, say suppose, for example, a globe is there, I have to fit my right hand. okay, into which the drug molecule, this is like a receptor site, and this is like glove is like receptor site, and this hand is like that of the drug molecule. Drug molecule must fit to bring about its effect into the receptor site. So it is clear why a left oriented drug is more effective in binding to a left hand receptor than its right oriented enantiomer. So until and unless this drug molecule gets the perfect fit, otherwise it will not produce its own pharmacodynamic action. So that is like that receptor site and drug molecule has to fit in properly. The more active enantiomer at one type of receptor site may not be more active at another receptor site type. That is like one will be more potent, one will be less potent. And another thing is that one will be more potent at more active at one receptor site, not at the other receptor site. Example, carvedilol, a drug that interacts with adrenoceptors, has a single chiral center and thus two enantiomers. One of these enantiomers, the S or negative isomer, is a potent beta receptor blocker. The R or positive isomer is 100-fold weaker at the beta receptors. Okay, we'll see what is positive and negative in the subsequent slides. However, the isomers are approximately equipotent as alpha receptor blockers. So this is like one action at beta receptor and one action at alpha receptor. So they need not be same, and the efficacy may not be the same, and it may be more active at one receptor and less active at one receptor. So here I have given the picture of enantiomer. This is a mirror image. So you can see clearly here, mirror image. So you can't always overlap the enantiomers on other things. So for example, if you want to keep this molecule on this molecule, so H ion, hydrogen ion will overlap on chloride ions, and here chloride ions on hydrogen ions. That is the point that I have discussed till now. Okay, so they are called as chiral molecules. Ketamine is an intravenous anesthetic. The positive enantiomer is more potent anesthetic and is less toxic than the negative enantiomer. Unfortunately, the drug is still used as a racemic mixture. Racemic mixture means the combination of both the positive and negative. Positive negative means otherwise known as dextroisomer and levoisomer. So one will be more potent and one will be less potent. But the racemic mixture means certain drugs are available as racemic mixtures which contain both the dextro and levo rotatory forms. That is stereoisomerism. Then some drugs will have only dextro compounds and some drugs will have only levo compounds. So we'll see the difference, what is the difference between all these molecules in regards to the clinical efficacy. Finally, because enzymes are usually stereoselective, one drug enantiomer is often more susceptible than the other to drug metabolizing enzymes. So one enantiomer more susceptible for metabolism than the other. As a result, the duration of action of one enantiomer may be quite different from that of the other. So everything is different between two enantiomers. Similarly, drug transporters also may be stereoselective. Same thing with enzymes and drug transporters even. Unfortunately, most studies of clinical efficacy and drug elimination in humans have been carried out with racemic mixtures of drugs rather than with the separate active enantiomers like dextro and levo. We have racemic mixture for majority of the drugs. As a result, most patients receiving drug doses of which 50% is less active or inactive, because 50% is dextro, 50% is levo, and we want only dextro molecule to get the needed therapeutic effect. So this 50% molecule of the levo form is of no use, less active or inactive, even if you administer it to the patient. That is the point. Some drugs are currently available in both the racemic and the pure active isomer forms. However, proof that administration of the pure active enantiomer decreases adverse effects relative to those produced by racemic formulations has not yet been established. So one thing is 50% efficacy is lost in majority of the cases, whether it is less active or even inactive. But if you take only active enantiomer, we can't say that the ADR potential of that particular molecule will be less when compared to the racemic mixture. That is not proven till now. Then comes rational drug design. Rational design of drugs is the ability to predict the appropriate molecular structure of a drug on the basis of information about the about its biological receptor. So that means you have a receptor. Based on the nature of the receptor, you need to design a molecular structure of a drug. It is reverse. So until recently, no receptor was known in sufficient detail to permit such drug design. Instead, drugs were developed through random testing of chemicals or modification of drugs already known to have some effect. Like, for example, we have extracted something from plants, and then from the crude extract, the chemicals are isolated, and then they were tested randomly to know what kind of systems they are affecting, what kinds of pharmacodynamic actions they are producing. And another thing is that we have old molecules, and we are going to test whether these molecules have any new effect or not. Okay. And characterization of many receptors during the phase three decade, during the past three decades has changed this picture. A few drugs now in use were developed through molecular design based on knowledge of the three-dimensional structure of the receptor site. So computer programs are now available that can optimize drug structures to fit known receptors. So as more becomes known about receptor structure, rational drug design will become more common. So we have the three-dimensional structure of the receptors. Based on that, molecular designing will be done. So this particular receptor molecule will have different receptor sites, binding sites. So based on that, a molecule is designed through computer, and then it is developed in the laboratory. That is what is known as rational drug design. Then receptor nomenclature. Newer and more effective ways to identify and characterize receptors. And we have like a receptor and nomenclature and drug classification given by International Union of Pharmacology Committee, UFAR. Then comes the sources of drugs. Let us see. So I'm going to cover under this the plant sources and the various like alkaloids, glycosides, oils, gums, tannins, and resins. And then animal sources, microorganisms, minerals, human sources, synthetic compounds. And then the latest technology, that is DNA recombinant technology, hybridoma technique, gene-based therapy, stem cell therapy, and then nanomedicines. First, let us see what are the plant sources of drugs. Many plants contain biologically active substances and are the oldest source of drugs. So we have discussed in the evolution of pharmacology, oldest source of drug is Ayurvedic Materia Medica from China and India. Okay, so the Ayurvedic, even allopathic medicines in good olden days, like it is not exactly allopathic medicines. We can't say it is like a herbal product only from the plants. So that was the oldest source of drugs. Medicinal plants were obtained from traditional systems of medicine prevalent in various parts of the world. That is like use of opium, belladonna, ephedra, cinchona, curare, foxglove, serpagandha, Jinghaso, has been learned from Egyptian, Greek, Aztec, Ayurvedic, and Chinese and other systems of medicine. That's what we have seen in the evolution of pharmacology. Then alkaloids. So the plant products are subdivided into various categories. Let us see one by one. Number one is alkaloids. Alkaloids, oid means similar kind of. So they have the properties similar to that of alkalis. So they are alkali-like substances which are insoluble in water, but their salts are soluble in water. Like atropine, as such, it is like insoluble in water. But when you prepare atropine sulfate from the extraction, so it can be soluble in water like that. Atropine from Atropa belladonna, morphine from Papaver somniferum plant, quinine from cinchona bark, reserpine from Rauwolfia serpentina, and nicotine from tobacco leaves. So if you observe, the names of all alkaloids usually end with NE, atropine, morphine, quinine, reserpine, nicotine. So it ends with NE. So here you can see nicotine plant, Atropa belladonna plant, and opium, that is morphine is crude gummy extract. Here you can see, okay. Then Vinca rosea, Vinca alkaloids from, this is the most common plant that you will see everywhere. So used in the management of cancer, and digitalis plant, which is used for congestive heart failure, and anti-malarial drug, bran is extracted from cinchona bark, and reserpine, an antihypertensive agent, is extracted from the plant Rauwolfia serpentina. How you are going to extract this plant products? So alkaloids which are present in the plants. So suppose, for example, morphine, we can see. Opium poppy. So this is opium poppy. This is one. So this poppy is taken, so capsule is taken, and then the opium, that is the dried juice of the poppy seed capsule, so from that the juice will be exuding out. So that juice is taken out and it is dried out. Gummy mass will be liberated, dried juice. Then this extract, when it is dried, and then it will be made into a form of powder, that is, that will contain morphine. Not the entire plant we are taking, we are taking just juice of the poppy seed capsule. So this morphine is isolated from the seed of the plant, Papaver somnifera. Okay, morphine plant. So then this powder drug is like named under prepared like morphine sulfate tablets, either oral solution or solution for injection. Okay, then comes the sources of alkaloids from various plant sources, like various parts of the plant, I can say. So you may be asked in Viva OC, this is like previously we used to have chemical pharmacology experiment, and now we don't know regarding the new curriculum whether we can include that or not. So but in generally Viva it will be asked. So the alkaloids which are obtained from various parts of the plant, like obtained from root, that is like Rauvolfia serpentina, Ipecacuanha, from bark, cinchona and cinnamon are extracted, and from fungus, that is like antibiotics like penicillins and ergots like Claviceps purpura are isolated, and from wood, sandalwood or camphor from Cinnamoma camphora are isolated, and then from leaf, digitalis from foxglove plant, atropine from Atropa belladonna, cocaine, nicotine, senna leaves, all these things are extracted. And from fruit, the alkaloid that is extracted is cardamom or opium. And from flower, Cannabis indica, and we call alkaloids like vincristine and vinblastine. And from the seed, Strophanthus, Physostigmine, and Pilocarpine. All these points are very, very important for Viva OC, and especially for postgraduate students. Then another plant product is, apart from alkaloids, we do have glycosides. Let us see what are glycosides. These are plant products where a sugar moiety is joined to a non-sugar moiety by ether linkage. So if sugar moiety is glucose, then it is named as glucoside. And if it is amino sugar, it is known as aminoglycoside. Okay. So aminoglycoside, whether it is a plant product or something else, let us see. So you should not get confused regarding that in BioOC. So on hydrolysis, so here sugar moiety, non-sugar moiety through ether linkage is there. So sugar moiety is responsible for pharmacokinetic property. Non-sugar moiety or aglycone or genin is responsible for pharmacological or pharmacodynamic activity. So on hydrolysis, these two moieties will get separated because ether linkage is broken down. Example, digoxin obtained from Digitalis purpura and ovine obtained from Strophanthus gratus. The active principle of senna and similar plant purgatives are anthraquinone glycoside. So examples of all glycosides. Most commonly you can say digoxin. And aminoglycosides. So we have discussed here. Aminoglycosides means in the chemical structure, the sugar moiety is amine sugar. So it is just the chemical structure, sugar moiety is amino sugar. Or like aminoglycosides like gentamicin, if we take one example, they are antibiotics obtained from microorganisms and have amino sugar in place of a sugar moiety. So you should not say, when we ask aminoglycosides what are the source of aminoglycosides, you should not say that it is plant product, it is from microorganisms. Please make a note of it. Then other plant products like oils. These are viscous, inflammable liquids, insoluble in water. The following three types of oils are used for various medicinal purposes. Number one is essential or volatile oils. Example, we just try to remember the name of that particular oil so that you can write everything about it if short notes is asked in your exam. So examples are eucalyptus oil, essential E for E eucalyptus oil, or clove oil, peppermint oil, or ginger oil, etc. They are obtained from leaves or flower petals by steam distillation. These are the physicochemical properties of the particular compound. They are steam volatile, have aroma, that is fragrance, eucalyptus oils, you must be aware of it. But they do not have any caloric or food value, not used in cooking. do not form soaps with the alkalis, do not become rancid or foul smelling on prolonged stay. But the uses are, they are used as carminatives, astringents, in mouthwashes, or as flavoring agents. So only for what is the main purpose? Carminative action, astringent, and then flavoring agents. Okay, so no food value. Then some of them may be solid at room temperature and sublimate on heating, like menthol and camphor. And the uses of various particular compounds are turpentine oil acts as counter irritant, lemon oil as flavoring agent, peppermint, cardamom, ginger, fennel, they do have carminative and flavoring actions, which are used in kitchen. Then eucalyptus oil relieves congestion, oil of clove relieves the dental pain. Then fixed oils, example, groundnut oil, coconut oil, and olive oil. F for fixed, F for food. You can remember that simple point. They're non-volatile. You can see they're not non-volatile. You can see in the kitchen. They have caloric or food value, edible and used for cooking. They form soaps with alkalis and become rancid after prolonged stay. You can't store them for a long period of time. Otherwise, you will get foul smelling. They're obtained by solvent extraction of crushed seeds. That girls must be aware of it. Then fixed oils have little pharmacological use except for castor oil, which has purgative action, and arachis oil for demulcent property. And cocoa butter or theobroma oil is used as emollient in skin cream and making suppositories, like the skin soothing effect that particular molecule produces. So you can see in cosmetics, cocoa butter is seen. Then mineral oils, they are obtained from dry installation of woods, and so they do not have any food value here also. Only fixed oils have food value. They do not stale when kept for prolonged periods. Example, hard and soft paraffin, which is used as a vehicle for or base for ointment preparations. And liquid paraffin, of course, used to prepare liquid paraffin emulsion, and also has a lubricant purgative action. And it also acts as a lubricant to facilitate certain procedures like urethral catheterization. Then comes gums. These are colloidal exudates or secretory products of plants. They swell or dissolve or form adhesive mucilage in water, if you mix with the water. They are used as emulsifying or suspending agent. So if you mix in another liquid, it will not get dissolved like all the ways. So example is gum acacia, gum tragacanth. PG students must be aware of this when they go for practical pharmacology. They'll be using this gum acacia. Then tannins. These are non-nitrogenous phenolic derivatives from plant source, soluble in water. They're mainly used as astringents. Example, tincture catechol and tincture rhubarb. A soothing layer and protective layer will be formed there to relieve the inflammation or irritation. Then resins, these are polymers of volatile oil and are insoluble in water. Benzoin used as inhalation in common cold. Then tincture benzoin used as antiseptic. Colophony used as ingredient in various plasters. Shellac for enteric coating of tablets. And tolu balsam used as an expectorant in cough mixtures. So these are all the plant products till now we have discussed. Then comes to the animal sources. The molecules that are derived from animal sources. Hormones. Insulin is isolated from or prepared from pork or beef pancreas. Examples you need to remember for YYOC. Thyroxin is isolated from pig or ox thyroid gland. Heparin, that is from leech, pig or ox liver. Vitamin B12 from liver extract. And vaccines and sera like BCG, cholera, smallpox, polio, anti-rabies vaccine, anti-diphtheritic vaccine, and anti-tetanus vaccine, all the sera are prepared from animal sources. Along with that, antitoxic sera is from anti-snake venom. Then another source is microorganism. So we have most of the antibiotics are obtained from fungi, actinomycetes, and bacteria. So examples are penicillin from Penicillium notatum, chloramphenicol from Streptomyces venezuelae. So the sources are bacteria, fungi, and actinomycetes. Greasyofulvin from Penicillium greasyofulvum, Streptomycin from Streptomyces griseus, Neomycin from Streptomyces fraidae, and Apart from antibiotics and antifungal drugs, other products are also produced from microorganisms. What are they? For example, streptokinase, an enzyme from gram-positive cocci. It is not an antibiotic, not an antifungal drug. Then enzyme diastase from fungi, and vitamin B12 from Streptomyces griseus, and vaccines are also produced by other microorganisms. These are the exceptional things, apart from routine antibiotics and antifungal drugs. Then another source is minerals. So we have like solid powder preparations, like ferrous sulfate, that is mineral used in the management of anemia, magnesium sulfate used as a purgative, aluminum hydroxide, calcium carbonate, sodium bicarbonate, they all act as like in the powder form, they act as antacids. Kaolin or aluminum silicate as adsorbent in antidiarrheal preparations. Then liquid preparations. Tincture iodine or povidone iodine solutions, they are used as antiseptics. Then radioactive isotopes are newer source of mineral drugs. Then iodine 131 for the diagnosis and treatment of thyrotoxicosis and thyroid malignancy. That is also. Then mineral preparations, one is solid, liquid, and then mineral preparations. These are petroleum products which are obtained by dry distillation of wood. They have no food value and do not become rancid, but they are mainly used as vehicles for preparation of ointments like hard and soft paraffin. Whereas liquid paraffin can be used as purgative. Then comes human source. What are the drugs or medicines which are extracted from humans? Immunoglobulins from blood, and from pituitary gland we get growth hormone, from placenta we get placental extract, and from the urine of pregnant women we get chorionic gonadotropins, and from human kidney cells we get urokinase. Then synthetic compounds. Presently, the majority of drugs are obtained synthetically or semi-synthetically, that we know. In the laboratory, we are going to get all the molecules, but by slight modification in the chemical structure. Some of the drugs which were earlier obtained from plant or animal source are today synthesized in the laboratories. This point we have already discussed. Advantages of developing synthetic compounds are quality can be better controlled by developing the molecules in the laboratory. And then process is easier and cheaper. So when compared to the costly extraction of the drug molecule from the crude extract through various procedures, and it's time taking also. Chemical structure of the prototype drug can be modified to get more potent and safer drugs. So by slight modification of the chemical structure, we can get the concerned efficacy and concerned safety in whichever way we want. Like for example, the examples for synthetic compounds are paracetamol, aspirin, chlorpenol, majority of the drugs. Many drugs are being synthesized to target specific biomolecules like ACE inhibitors, glycoprotein 2B or the 3A receptor antagonists, HIV reverse transcriptase inhibitors, etc. Synthetic drugs that are chiral can also be produced as single active enantiomer products, which may be therapeutically superior. Okay. So this is another innovative technology. Then comes another innovative technology, that is DNA recombinant technology. Drugs are prepared by genetic engineering, which means the manipulation of genetic material using DNA recombinant technology. So what is this? Let us see. Here, a desired gene is inserted into a very fast multiplying non-pathogenic strain of some bacteria. In bacteria, we are going to introduce the gene. Then the host cell will produce large amounts of the gene-directed proteins which are required. Host cell will produce the proteins. Because the bacteria will not have any potential to synthesize that particular group of proteins. So we are going to introduce into the bacteria, and host cell is going to produce a lot of number of proteins which we need. Example, humulin or human insulin by inserting pro-insulin gene into the body. So recombinex HB or a hepatitis vaccine is also synthesized in the same way. Interferons, alteplase, reteplase, protein factors 8 and 9 are synthesized. And also human erythropoietin, that hormone that stimulates production of RBCs, platelet-derived growth factor, all these are prepared with this DNA recombinant technology. Suppose, for example, hepatitis B vaccine, how it is synthesized, let us see. Formation of genetically engineered hepatitis B vaccine. Genetic material DNA is first extracted from hepatitis virus. We introduce and then extract. the gene that directs the production of surface protein is located. So when we inject, certain amount of proteins are released within the body of the patient. So the particular gene which directs the production of surface proteins, that particular gene is isolated, located. That gene, this gene is removed from viral DNA, and then we are going to insert it into plasmid. Then plasmid is again then inserted into yeast cells. Then what happens, yeast is grown by fermentation. So it is number of molecules will increase. Cells produce large amount of surface protein. So after 48 hours, yeast cells are ruptured and then extracted surface proteins. So whatever the number of proteins are synthesized, they are removed. And they are purified, stabilized with preserving agents that becomes a hepatitis B vaccine. Okay, this is how the vaccines are prepared. Then prepared by DNA recombinant technology. Then comes hybridoma technique. Monoclonal antibodies like zemtuzumab, alemtuzumab, infliximab, and adalimumab, etc., are synthesized by hybridoma technique. Apart from drugs, gene-based therapy and stem cell therapy are available today. Let us see what are they. Gene-based therapy. Using DNA recombinant technology, short nucleotide sequences or genes are synthesized. Genes are synthesized and used for the therapy, which are responsible for the in vivo synthesis of proteins critical in certain metabolic pathways. So they can be introduced into human beings for particular diseases, treating their conditions. Gene synthesized and then inserted into certain conditions. So purpose of gene therapy in cancer, to add new molecular functions capable of altering the course of the disease or to block an existing function. In either way, we can use it in the cancer chemotherapy. Gene transfer mediated vaccination is applicable to both infectious and non-infectious diseases. Objective of gene therapy is to introduce functional genetic material into mammalian cells to replace or supplement the activity of defective genes. So sometimes defective genes will be there in case of that is number one deficiency of the gene. And sometimes there will be faulty chemical composition of the protein product of the abnormal gene. So abnormal gene will be there, which is faulty. Sometimes gene itself is deficient. And third modality is accumulation of precursors which cannot be metabolized further because of the enzyme deficiency. So enzyme deficiency will be there, because of which no metabolism. So accumulation of precursors will be there. So in all these conditions, we need to go for gene therapy. Example, thalassemia, phenylketonuria, and cystic fibrosis, etc., where correction of metabolic abnormality by delivery of synthetic gene to the target tissue can be done by gene-based therapy. Then comes stem cell therapy. So recently, stem cells are either embryonic or adult pluripotent stem cells have been used as a therapeutic potential, therapeutic approach for regeneration and proliferation of functional cells in the body. Example, in myocardial infarction, osteoarthritis, diabetes, all these things, regeneration of the functional cells in the body can be revived. So it has very important role in therapeutics. Then comes nanomedicines. They are synthesized using nanotechnology. Nanotechnology is defined as the intentional design, characterization, production, and applications of materials, structures, devices, and systems by controlling their size and shape in the nanoscale range, that is 1 to 100 nanometers. Very small nanomolecules are synthesized within the laboratory with proper design. Nanomedicines are close to biological molecules in size and have very high surface ratio. Their outer surface nanomolecules are prepared, and their outer surface or their core can be loaded with chemicals, either metal or an organic substance. And this chemical substance, which is on the outer surface or inner core of this nanomolecule, can be administered either intralesionally in cancer chemotherapy or for IV administration as a contrast agent for diagnostic imaging. They are also being studied for in vitro measurement of molecules of interest in biological materials for diagnostic purpose. So one is curative and palliative, and then for diagnostic purpose. Long-term in vivo safety of these agents is still to be confirmed. Then comes the last point, that is last subtopic, that is sources of drug information. Let us see where do we can, from where we can get this information. So we need to get some information about a particular drug. So suppose, for example, methylene blue, which is used in the management of mucormycosis. I'll give you some time. If you can get the full details of information from where are, what are the sources that where you can get the information from, you can just like take a task about it after going through this particular session. Drug compendia. These are like compilations of information on drugs in the form of monographs. So you can see the monographs, you must have seen like monographs means it is like a simplified information, all entire information about the drugs in a small booklet. Without going into theoretical concepts, mechanism of action and other aspects which help in understanding the subject. So it will not be like representing the pharmacology book, just like nutshell of about that particular drug, which can be used like a clinical aspect of that particular drug can be given in this monograph. So we have two types of drug compendia. One is official, one is non-official. So we'll see the difference between those two. Official compendia. Pharmacopoeias and formularies, it is a little tough for you to understand at this stage, but it is very, very important to have the knowledge about it. So pharmacopoeias and formularies brought out by the government in a country, and they hold legal status. It is officially by the government of that particular country. So the compendias means, what is that we have seen here? So we have like monographs. So here we can have pharmacopoeias and formularies and that official compendia. Whereas non-official compendia published by professional bodies, any professional body can compile that one, which are supplementary and dependable sources of information about drugs. It is like secondary source of drug information. Then official compendia information is provided by non-proprietary names, otherwise known as generic name. For example, crocin is the molecule which contains generic name of that, this one is paracetamol. So it is provided by non-proprietary names of drugs, not by trade names. It is not like Dolapar or Dolo, okay? And non-official compendia, they provide the secondary source of drug information, and they provide useful information about drugs both by trade names and generic names, because they are like formed by professional bodies. They can do whatever they want to do. So it is useful for which are useful for like both trade names and generic names for a medical practitioner or pharmacist. That can be easily understood. Then official compendia, it is a compilation of legally approved drugs for use in that country along with their legal standards of purity, quality and strength. If the purity, quality and strength is adequate or appropriate as per the legal standards of that country, then only those drugs will be included in the official compendia. For example, we have pharmacopoeias and formularies. So they only those particular drugs will be included in that official compendia. Whereas non-official compendia, this information is generalized and not restricted to only legally approved drugs. All drugs will be included in that. So we can get, if you want any drug which is even legally not approved also, that drug information also you can get from non-official compendia. Full literature you can get. Examples are AMA drug evaluation by American Medical Association and Council on Drugs. And number two, Modern Drug Encyclopedia by Yorkie Medical Books, New York, USA. Then Physician's Desk Reference by Medical Economics Publications, USA. And then Martindale Extra Pharmacopoeia by Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain. This is very, 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 very useful book. You can even get the PDF of Martindale. You can see it's a very interesting book. Martindale, The Complete Drug Reference. The complete drug reference means extra pharmacopoeia, encyclopedia, like that. Extra pharmacopoeia means all details about all the drugs can be given in this. Complete drug reference. So it is published every 2 to 3 years by the Royal Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain. It is from the Britain. And it is a compendium published periodically over the last 120 years. It has been getting published every year. Okay. It includes new launches and contains pharmaceutical, pharmacological, as well as therapeutic information on drugs, which can serve as reliable reference book. If you want to know any drug, then you can just open the Martindale, you will get the information about it. There is like a very structured, organized book you can see. So it is like categorized into several separate sections and put properly in alphabetical order. And all these details, entire details of that particular molecule, you can get. The non-official compendium, this is Martindale, is non-official compendium, is an exhaustive and updated compilation of unbiased information on drugs and medicines used throughout the world, not only from one country, including their trade names and manufacturer's contact information also you will get. And it also includes plant drugs, diagnostic agents, radiopharmaceuticals, pharmaceutical excipients, toxins and poisons, everything. It also provides synopsis of treatments for diseases, what not. You will get entire information about a particular drug and then its clinical implication, diagnostic implication, and pharmaceutical implications, and everything you will get. The drug information is backed by references, systematic reviews, and meta-analysis or evidence-based guidelines. All these research-oriented links are also given, and that information is also given in detail. So it does serves as an excellent source of drug information. That is Martindale, otherwise known as Complete Drug Reference. You can get entire thing in that book. Different brands of same medicine are marketed by different manufacturers. Is it not? Information about the brands, their formulations, strengths, cost, dose, and precautions, adverse effects, contraindications, everything is available in publications such as Physician's Desk Reference and Indian Drug Review, Monthly Index of Medical Specialties, or SIMS, or even India website also. You can get all the information of different brands and different companies which release different brands, their formulations, strengths, and all the pharmacological information in these things. Then, what is the difference between pharmacopoeia and formulary? Let us see. An official code containing a selected list of the established drugs and medicinal preparations with descriptions of their chemical structure, molecular weight, physical and chemical characteristics, solubility, identification, assay method, standards of purity, storage conditions, and dosage forms of officially approved drugs in a country. So all the physicochemical characteristics you can write down and pharmacological properties. So what you have to remember, official code containing a selected list of established drugs and officially approved drugs. Established drugs and officially approved drugs in that particular country. Whereas formulary means it provides product information on drugs available to prescribers in respective countries or states or health systems. So it is not like only approved drug. All the drugs, information regarding all the drugs are given in formulary. So formularies can be considerably helpful to prescribers. So they will have idea about everything, even the banned drugs also. Provides information about the available drugs based on original and reported drug formation sources as well as expert recommendations. So which is more efficacious, and all these different, information regarding the comparison is also given here. Pharmacopoeia defines the standards by which these preparations must meet and may mention in their average doses for an adult, essential drugs, and then approved drugs. So they need to have, follow certain standards. That is pharmacopoeia. Then formulary means generally produced in easily carried booklet form, listing indications, dosage forms, contraindications, precautions, adverse effects, storage of selected drugs that are available for medicinal use in a country. So it deals with the pharmaceutical ingredients also. In small booklet, all these pharmacological information and pharmaceutical information is also given in that. And drugs are categorized by their therapeutic class. Some rational fixed dose combinations are also included in this. And then pharmacopoeias, they are useful to drug manufacturers and regulatory authorities, but not to doctors. Whereas formulary is mostly used by prescribers because they have like all essential and non-essential drugs, established drugs and non-established drugs, everything will be given here, and aids rational prescribing and dispensing of drugs. Pharmacopoeias, they have legal standing from the point of view of drug regulatory authority that we have discussed also. They limit the drug information up to drug substances and dosage forms. And here we have formulary, like examples, National Formulary of India is published by Government of India. British National Formulary, this is the BNF book that is most common British medical professionals, they follow every day for their clinical practice, is jointly published by British Medical Association and the Royal Pharmaceutical Society, BNF, very important thing. And pharmacopoeias, its committee has predominance of physicians, whereas formulary, pharmacists also. At British Pharmacopoeia, we have the example here, and in connection to the pharmacopoeia, formulary is Pharmaceutical Codex, which is developed by Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain. And we have United States Pharmacopoeia, here National Formulary by American Pharmaceutical Association. Indian Pharmacopoeia, in its place, formulary means National Formulary of India. Then comes the final thing, that is British Pharmaceutical Codex that we have discussed here. British Pharmaceutical Codex, second one. It is published by Council of Pharmaceutical Society of Great Britain, gives information about drugs, other pharmaceutical substances and formulated products. Further, it provides standards for identification purity for a range of substances and the materials for which standards are not provided with the British pharmaceuticals. So this is about British Pharmaceutical Codex. So thank you all for your patient listening. So if you have any doubts regarding this session, you may WhatsApp to me personally. So at my leisure time, I will answer you. Hope this clarifies you the concepts of the principles of pharmacology. So we have done first session, the principles of pharmacotherapeutics. And then the second session is principles of pharmacology. Every subtopic is equally important because it is CBME curriculum. So don't waste your time. And I may keep any sudden test so that I will come to know whether you are listening to the lecture as soon as it is uploaded, and anytime I'll be calling you all for the test. And if you don't get good marks, I'll not be given an attendance. Okay, that is the only criteria that I try to follow. Okay, so soon we may come back to the offline teaching. So hope so, maybe soon. So that will be more interactive sessions, and it is enlivening more than interaction. It will be enlivening sessions, it can be, if the students are there in front. So thank you. Thank you, one and all.